I want to bring a few people to the stage right now. These are not, by a long shot, the only people who have been responsible for making SOCAP happen. There's a very tiny staff, and then a lot of folks who are volunteering, who have proposed sessions, who have put together sessions, who are helping you find your seats, who are guiding you to different places, who are running to get coffee for folks who need it and making this thing run. And they're called the volunteers. They are wearing gray T-shirts. There is one back here at the exit. He's waving at you. And he has on a gray T-shirt with this great mandala on it. So when you need something, look for someone in a gray T-shirt that says SOCAP, and they should be able to help you. Now, I want to bring onto the stage five very important people who have worked very hard to make this event what it is today. I want to introduce them to you. We have Lindsay Smalling, who is the Director of Programming. And Lindsay, you'll see her face a lot of places, but she is the person who has put together almost every bit of the content. A new person on our team this year is Jamie McGonigal, who's our Director of Business Development. And without his work, we would not be here. Absolutely. And Justin Bellamy from JB Marketing in Asheville, North Carolina, is our Director of Marketing. And his team have brought all of you here, whether you know it or not. Then two other folks who are on this team, Tim Sorens, who is the Director of manages the meaning track at SOCAP, and Lizzie Zellerbach-Rufer, who works with Tim. And they are not only working on SOCAP, but they are working on an event called Neighborhood Economics, which will be in Cincinnati November 17th and 18th. And if you want more information about Neighborhood Economics, see one of them or go to the website neighborhoodeconomics.org. Thank you. So thank you very much. We'll be introducing some more folks to you who have helped with SOCAP, but we want to say a special thank you to these five. This morning when Kevin and I were talking with Tim Sorens, actually, Kevin was telling us a story about somebody who came to one of the SOCAP events and actually went home, made a difference, invited a group of folks here, and a whole cadre of people from her community are here, and they are going back to change lives in that neighborhood, in that city that's very devastated by the economics that's going on in this country right now. And Tim and Kevin and I were talking about how many lives are going to be changed in this country and around the world because of the work that you all are doing when you leave this place. And we want to tell you how proud we are and how humbled we are to be able to bring you all together and to be a part of the story of changing the world that each of you is living in your own lives. So thank you to you for being here, but more than that, thank you for the work that you do in your hometowns and around the world. Now, Kevin is going to come to the stage and spend a little time with us reflecting on where we've been and an overview for not only the next 4 days, but a bit of a reflection about where we're headed with this thing called impact investing and social enterprise. Welcome to the stage, Kevin Jones.
Thank you. Welcome to SOCAP. This is our 10th and largest conference by far, with 2,700 people here, 500 more than last year, from 70 countries, 10 more countries than last year. We've grown more and faster than other conferences in the space of impact investing and social enterprise because of one key design principle. It's that one thing we do different from everybody else. While other conferences pride themselves on getting the right person in the room, we've always been about introducing you to the valuable stranger, the unlikely ally, where others use the metaphor of the summit and try to make sure the pre-validated and the powerful are in the right places around the table. We use the metaphor of an oasis, where people from isolated caravans meet in a space between the silos, and people come out of their tents to that surprisingly abundant place right here in between, where you meet the valuable strangers, the unlikely allies, potential partners, investees or co-investors you would not have found on your ordinary path. Now, speaking of valuable strangers, we're really thrilled with all the cohorts from around the world who've come here to learn and share what they know with us. The 30 or so people from Japan, the 40 mayors and angel investors and techies who were part of the Nordics Go SOCAP, the LATAM SOCAP that had their own regional pitch session yesterday, as well as our partners from SANCAP and all the other people from India. We're expanding into looking at public companies this year, and we're delivering funded research on Divest Invest that outlines how you or your foundation can outperform the market by investing in public companies that are free of fossil fuels. That's an area we're going to go into more as we go forward. We want to help people put all their money where their heart is and get a good return doing it. A big sign that this market is evolving is something we're calling the SODA initiative, the SOCAP Social Capital Data Commons. Half a dozen digital platforms for impact investing and social entrepreneurs have gotten together to share the key kernel of data, the definition of what an enterprise is. Now, their agreement to share data will improve investors' due diligence and assessment of comparable companies. The collaborating pioneers include Artha, working in India and South and Central America, SVX, working in Canada, the US, and Mexico, Impact IQ, StartGrid, the Resilience Exchange, and SOCAP itself. It's a big step. I'm going to describe it. People have been agreed for years that this is the kind of thing that needs to be done to help us coordinate between our respective siloed digital platforms. This year we've done it. It matters, and we'll be adding other partners soon. Platforms beginning to interoperate and share data is a phase shift in the market. The economist Ronald Coase said markets evolve through three phases, from discovery, figuring out who's doing what, kind of where we were in 2008, to cooperation, where there's one-off agreements, to coordination, where everybody agrees on a signal and it's automated. That's the space where railroads and stock exchanges play, and the SOTA initiative is in that space of coordination too. It's analogous to the time when railroads agreed on a gauge for their rails and you didn't have to offload freight from the Erie to the Illinois Central. It's a small thing that will reduce a lot of friction and enable big things to build on top of it. It's an essential agreement, like when they set up internet protocols. It may sound complicated, but it's the kind of thing that will make it easier for entrepreneurs and investors to put their money where their meaning is to create the world we need in the face of climate change and wealth disparity. SOCAP is a global conference of people using business to make a difference, fueled by investing, layered increasingly with philanthropy and some smart public money. But it's a convening of people working in particular places. In the smartest places, all those things come together in a focus we've labeled neighborhood economics. In our neighborhood economics track, we've got sessions about how that's happening in New Orleans, Detroit, Vancouver, Louisville, Kentucky, and Providence, Rhode Island, and how they made that happen. Usually, they're finding a way to pay for a community quarterback, the person who connects the dots and helps create the connective tissue in the local economy, acting like a cross between a culturally literate merchant banker and an entrepreneurial community organizer. It takes a new mix of philanthropic, public, and risk capital and no-interest loans to entrepreneurs who don't have collateral to make this work, and it seems to work best in a community. People working in the local economies, the neighborhood-based inclusive economies, can see what they need to get done to create places where their kids will want to move back. They get over their dogma when they can think and act locally. That's what we're focusing on that we call Neighborhood Economics Track this year at SOCAP and in the follow-on event in November in Cincinnati, where we're putting those ideas to work. It's business building wealth-creating opportunities in marginalized neighborhoods. It's not charities. It's business creating wealth-creating opportunities in marginalized neighborhoods. Now, we're intentional about valuable strangers at SOCAP. It's our theme and our design. But we have to become aware of it to take action on it. We first started looking at gender inclusion about 4 years ago, and this will be our fourth conference where no panel has all men on it. And this time we're adding a new question we want to be just as intentional about and apply consistently in the coming years. Why is it that impact investors have put more dollars to work on investments for good in Africa than investing with African Americans? White American impact investors don't run into their politics or their prejudices if they're jumping into the global hotbed of financial inclusion and mobile money in East Africa. It's time in a world where Black Lives Matter to look at how impact investing is and can be part of the solution. It's not charity, it's finding opportunity for wealth creation through a mix of entrepreneurship and investment. That's a question we're going to keep asking. We're bringing in people who are doing it, and we want to figure out how to do it better and more cooperatively. So there's a lot packed in over the next 3 days. This is our biggest conference, and we think you'll agree it's our best. Welcome to SOCAP. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. We're thrilled to have Gar Alperowitz with us back after having been with us a couple of years back. Gar has, over the life of SOCAP, been someone who has shaped our thinking. And this year, he is back to introduce some of the new work that he is doing as co-chair of the Next System Project. And to introduce Gar, we have a video, and then he and a group of folks who are working with him will come to the stage. So let's look at Gar's video.
Societies, civilizations, in some sense, are like our bodies. If there's something systemically wrong, it's manifesting all over the place. In all our organs, and that seems to be what's going on in our world at the moment.
The system is failing all around us.
Our infrastructure is falling apart. Our jails are full and can't hold more people. Our young people are burdened with $1 trillion in student debt.
We're in a heap of trouble.
When the temperature of the earth is starting to rise, that's a very bad sign. Our earth is running fever, and it's running it because it's sick in many ways.
In a country like the United States, the fact that anywhere from 45 to 50 million people are hungry, this is a problem.
We can't go on like this. We can't keep moving toward climate catastrophe, nuclear war, persistence of inequality, poverty, famine.
There is a systems problem. These are not one-off issues. They are interconnected, and we have to look at the system as a whole.
It's time to talk about alternatives. It's time to talk about what's next.
We need to be aspirational and be clear about the vision of the world that we want.
What is the system that humanizes us? What is the system that opens up our imagination of possibilities of cooperation?
Nothing is more important right now than to discuss how can we bring about this change.
As systems fail, individual and community creativity explodes, and that's what we have seen. People in this country are solving the problems themselves. They're coming up with new models and strategies. And within those models and strategies are the kernels of a systemic way to move forward.
Land trusts.
Cooperatively owned businesses.
Sustainable energy.
State-owned banks.
Urban gardening. Urban farming.
These small successes taken together are a proof of concept that this can happen on a larger scale.
We're compelled to search for alternatives, not just analytically, but in how we live and what we do, how we organize our daily lives. And that has tremendous potential.
Our actions and our imagination have to match the magnitude of this problem.
We have to get out of our comfort zone. We must think with courage.
All bets are off in terms of
our previous thinking, our ways of thinking about the economy and our ways of thinking about politics have proven an abject and utter failure. The good news is we have no choice but to adopt revolutionary thinking. I like that.
That's the exciting part about this moment. When there are no rules, then people have freedom to invent and to create new things.
I have no doubt that we can create a better America.
If the people who cared about these things really joined together to do something about them, anything is possible.
The biggest worry for me is that we don't try, is that we don't push for what we know is right, for what we know is possible.
It's time for everybody who cares about this country and the future of the planet to do something about it, to get involved.
We can actually do better. We can build a better system. It's not impossible. It's a very American thing to do, to build a new system.
It's a challenge. We can do it collectively, neighborhood by neighborhood, step by step.
I think that the world that we're on the verge of is bright and beautiful and interesting one. Complex, local, interconnected. I hope we get there.
It's time to talk about what's next. Please come and sign our statement at thenextsystem.org.
Good morning. I'm Gar Alperovitz. I'm co-chair of the Next System Project. We produced that film. And I'm here to pose a question to you. Why would it be that Kevin asked us to start this plenary session about changing the system? And what in the world does that mean? So I want to suggest to you that you let that question kind of sit in your lap like a friend of mine says, like a brick. Why in the world are we talking about changing the entire system over time? And then the second question is, are we up to that? Can we move from projects and strategies and new adventures to the system question? Now, there's different ways to get at that, but my favorite way of looking at it is the people who started Davos have asked the question publicly, is capitalism over? Other people are saying, is socialism over, and getting a definite answer. The Academy of Management, the U.S. Academy of Management, 10,000 management specialists, professors of business, advisors of major corporations, last year held their major conference on the question, are we reaching an end both to capitalism and socialism? Now, that's what used to be called a heavy, heavy question. But I want to throw it to you and let it sit in your lap again. And the question then is, what does that mean for our lives? And specifically, looking down the gun barrel of the next three decades, what might be the evolution of the work each of us is doing that might move from where we are over time to larger and larger issues and scale? So just that's the question, and I think if you look at what Kevin's been doing, the whole progression of SOCAP has been moving in that direction, and I think he's going to be talking more and more, for instance, about worker-owned companies and transformations of a different kind. That's step one. Step two is recognition a little bit of some of the reasons people are talking that way and just a few statistics. I used to be a college professor, so you have to allow me. There are a few things, and here they go. These are United States, but they're paralleled in many parts of the world. The share of income of the top 1% has gone from 10% of the income to 21.4% of income over the last 20 years. It has doubled, the 1% on top. The 1% on top has something like 400 people at the top. 400 people, you can get them in the front half of this discussion, have more wealth now than the bottom 180 million people taken together. The concentration of wealth in this country is technically medieval. But I said that once, and a medieval professor came up to me and said, no, you're wrong. It was never that concentrated in the medieval era. That means we're living in a system, the whole larger system, in which something is going wrong that has to be corrected by building somehow from what we're doing over time to another level. And the trick here is whether we can actually ourselves begin to see it that way rather than what I call projectism. I am strongly in favor of projects. We get nowhere without projects. And if they only stay at projects, we don't develop. So that, again, is another way to ask the question personally, where might we take this over time if we got serious about the next direction and moving the ball forward? So let me give you a few more statistics, and not many more because I'm going to stop very quickly. Prisoners in American jails are 8 times per capita more than any other country. We are more concentrated in prisoners in jails now than the Soviet Union was. And the number of blacks is 6 times the number of whites in those jails. Again, an indication of the depth of this, of the problem that is a systemic problem and not simply a problem of projects or policy or politics. Those are the kinds of questions we need to scale. And of course, and I won't get deeply into this, you all know better than I do the climate challenge and what it brings to us. Where does that take us? How do we begin to think forward? There are two analogies that I'd like to suggest to you in terms of how individuals might grapple with this problem. My heroes, my real heroes, are the people working in Mississippi, building up the civil rights movement that became the civil rights movement in the 1930s and 40s. You don't know their names. Most people don't know their names. Those are people who risked their lives in the quiet unknown, doing projects, developing forward, laying down the groundwork upon which the great civil rights explosion occurred 25 years later. So if you can see yourself, if we can see ourselves not only as doing projects, but asking the question how we might build forward over time, laying groundwork step by step, changing ourselves as we go, so that the next great explosion becomes transformative of the system that's producing those kinds of numbers. This is happening all over the world. The numbers are different, but the same question. How do we? It is a problem not only of hard work, it's a problem of self-identity. When you look in that mirror in the morning and see that brick lying in your lap about the system, how do I build and see and think through that? Another way of thinking about the system problem that gives a different handle on it. If you look at the great reforms of the New Deal era, the things that changed, Social Security, labor law, pensions, all those things, they did not come out of nowhere. They came out of the work of people like the people in this room 10 and 20 years earlier who were working in the state and local, quote, laboratories of democracy, building forward over time. Proof of concept, one of the people in the film said, beginning to refine and developing new concept, expanding and transforming, and laying groundwork so that when the time was right, much larger change could occur. That's another way to think about how we relate to the system crisis, not just the problem that we're facing in the projects that we're doing and the exciting work that's going on. And it is, again, strange to say, a problem of self-identity. Who are we in the matter? Who is the person in your seat in the matter? How do we self-identify? How do we expand? And how do we move in a way that I think is interesting that Kevin has moved both from this direction, the whole SOCAP direction, and backstage he just told me about a large venture in which they're transforming to worker ownership, not just social investing. So there are broad perspectives on all this. It also means going to scale and considering difficult things happening around the country. Our own group, the Democracy Collaborative, has been heavily involved in a big project in Cleveland, Ohio, where there are a number of worker-owned cooperatives. One has the largest urban solar installation in the country. Another one is a huge industrial-scale laundry, uses less water, less heat than any other laundry in that area. And a third one is the largest urban greenhouse in the United States, 3 million heads of lettuce a year. So we're taking it to scale And also we're finding support from big universities, anchor institutions, hospitals, who are now more and more willing to come to play and begin helping develop a scaled-up direction. That's only one. We're going to hear about several other directions that are now happening from the rest of the panel. But I want to give you the sense of scaling. And tomorrow morning, there is a very interesting group going on that will be speaking on this subject in the impact investing and what universities and hospitals are doing around the country. Tyler Norris will be there speaking as well, and I urge you to go to that afterward. And you'll get a sense of what's happening with the big institutions beginning to move in this direction as supportive, and I'm sure many of you know about that. But the issue of scaling up becomes part of it. And laying down that groundwork step by step, pre-New Deal, pre-Mississippi, building towards where another leap can happen. And again, it goes back to what is it we're doing? Are we doing projects? Yes. Are we doing good projects? Yes. Are we self-identifying with a sense of changing that entire system that's producing these kinds of statistics? That is the large order question. I want to take you one further step down that line. I think there is some possibility also ultimately of moving this into movement politics, movement development, politics in general, and that too is part of the larger direction that's beginning to build, and you find at this conference as well. SOCAP did not actually have movement building and politics as part of the discussions. That too is entering the range of what might be possible. At the national level, let me also remind you, and again, thinking down the line, I'm a historian and a political economist. Did you happen to notice that at the last big crisis, we nationalized the big banks and we nationalized Chrysler and General Motors? Somehow very large institutions are likely to be in play. No one knows what to do with large institutions. What is it, a system that has big, big institutions? And how does what we learn in the projects we are developing allow us to think forward to those moments that are going to happen? And how do we think about the prototypes that might cast a vision of a system design, something that takes us beyond the failing systems of socialism and corporate capitalism? That is the big, big set of questions that, if you stand back from this kind of a gathering, pose themselves inevitably if you allow that to happen. If you look in the mirror in the morning and say, is that what I personally am up to? Is that how we might go forward? Is that possibility real? So I ask you that both as a historian and a political economist to consider what we're doing here today, and particularly this panel where you'll hear some very exciting work going on that takes the next step down that direction, to pose it in the largest frame and to keep stretching it out and always asking the question, with that big brick sitting in your lap, the system as a whole, really, us, maybe in our time in history, allow that to seep in. And I'm confident, knowing what's happened at SOCAP and knowing the kind of people who are already in this room, that that kind of a challenge is the kind of challenge that begins to move the ball forward in an exciting way, taking all of this to a whole nother level so that 5 years and 10 years out, the meetings at SOCAP will be 10 times this big, and we will, in fact, be a movement that's beginning to rise to that particular question. Thank you very much. I want to introduce Angela Glover-Blackwell, who is CEO of Policy Link.
Thank you, Gar. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for whatever it is that made you think this is the place you needed to be. We have to begin to talk about changing the system, because if we don't change the system, we'll be back at this point again, no matter how much incremental progress we make as we try to redefine the way that we think about investment, the way that we think about business, the way that we think about the future. Gar mentioned a couple of things. I don't know if he mentioned the GI Bill, but something he said made me think about it if he didn't mention it. The GI Bill, when we think about Social Security, when we think about FHA and all it did to build housing in this nation, those things had many wonderful qualities. In fact, they made the middle class that made this nation and allowed it to stand on the world stage with such pride. But there was really a huge hole in all of those things because they didn't get to people of color. The GI Bill really was for white veterans. Social Security left out people who were picking vegetables and doing domestic work. The FHA actually explicitly excluded black people from being able to take advantage of it, and it allowed neighborhoods to develop in middle-class areas that created middle-class areas in this nation and locked so many people who were black out of home ownership or out of home ownership that actually could build any value for them to pull out if they needed it. We're a nation in which racism has been baked in. Exclusion has been baked in. And if we don't have a system that changes that, whatever system we come up with is going to be flawed. It is so wonderful that you are here having this conversation because we really need for investment and business to drive the change that we need. We won't get the change without power, politics, and policy. But in order to get to power, politics, and policy, the nation as a whole needs to change. It needs to change. Let me tell you what I mean. There is really nothing more valuable at this moment than the diversity that defines this nation. That what could be more valuable in a global economy than a world nation that has all of the diversity that is needed? But we're not valuing it, we're not using it, we're not dependent on it, we're not using it to define how well we're operating. Once we start doing that, we're going to push for policies that allow all to participate, prosper, and reach their full potential. Once we start doing that, we're going to recognize we need to have elected officials who are committed to the change that we need. Once we start doing that, we will be able to marshal the power that it's going to take to transform everything. We're living in a nation right now in which two things are defining the moment. One is the toxic inequality that's hollowing out the middle class, baking in poverty, and making it very hard for the mobility that this nation has prided itself upon to be able to still act. That toxic inequality threatens everything that we believe in. At the same time that we're starting to deal with that, recognize that we have to address it, we are undergoing an extraordinary demographic shift. We know that by 2043, the majority of people who live in the United States will be of color. Many people don't know that since 2012, the majority of babies being born in this country are of color. And by the end of this decade, 2019, the majority of all children under 18 will be of color. By 2030, the majority of the young workforce will be of color. As we think about the shifting demographics, as we think about the economic imperative, it's clear that the way forward is the way that will bring these two together, allow the shifting demographics to be the asset that they actually are, to be able to fuel a new vision for what it can be to all be in this together. But we've got to have a plan for doing that. We've got to grow good jobs, and we have to do it with every investment that we're making. It's not like we make an investment. It's not like we engage in a big thing like the transformation of the Oakland Army Base in Oakland. You can't do those things without thinking about how do you create good jobs in the process. Every time we spend money, we have to figure out a way to create good jobs and make sure the people who need them are going to get them. That includes creating entrepreneurships for people who are of color, because people of color hire people of color. If we need to get people of color employed, we need to make sure that the employers are of color. We need to build capabilities. We know that we don't have the capabilities for the work that has to go forward. We have to consciously invest in it. And we have to remove barriers and expand opportunity. Remove barriers like the disadvantage that is placed on people when they come out of prison with a record. We have to remove those barriers. We have to stop people from being able to be cut off from opportunity just because we have had a scandalous criminal justice system and the scandal of incarceration and the label that we have put on people who haven't deserved that label. We have to move that barrier. We have to expand opportunity. We have to make sure that this is not true anymore. Where you live in America is a proxy for opportunity. You live in a poor neighborhood, your chances are fixed before you even get started. That should not be in a nation like this. Thank you.
Thank you, Angela. Brendan Martin, Director of Working World.
Hi. Is
this on?
Great, thank you. So I want to talk a little bit about expand a bit more on what this next system looks like. It doesn't look like the current system of centralized, blunt answers to our global problems. The next system is local. The next system is based on people in power meeting the needs of their communities and solving our problems. Now, in the video that we watched that Gar put on, there was some examples or some stories told about people in power, their local economy. Well, these stories are real, and I've seen them over and over again. I lived in Argentina for 7 years, working with factories that had been closed, not because the factories weren't working, but because the global financial system was in default. And workers decided not to care about that logic, and they went and took over their factories, and they started running them again. And with the production that they were able to do in those factories, they met the needs of their communities, and they themselves solved the problems of this global financial system. It was in Argentina that I started The Working World. We are an organization that finances, that brings capital to worker and community-owned enterprise. And I've met hundreds of such enterprises. We worked directly with hundreds of enterprises that pragmatically functioned to control by their workers, meeting their community needs. We've made over 1,000 investments in these enterprises. I've worked directly with tens of thousands of workers, and we've invested millions of dollars. Over 90% of the people who are owners in these enterprises are people of color. Now, one of the greatest things about people-controlled economy is that taken as a whole, it's extremely effective. 98% of those 1,000 investments we've made have paid off in full with profit sharing and interest. In Chicago, a factory that was closed, where workers used to be making minimum wage, with an investment we gave those workers, they reopened the factory. They're now helping to run that factory themselves. They're making twice what they used to make. My late dear friend Ricky Macklin, he was born picking cotton. He spent time in our nation's penitentiary system. But when he died owning his own business. The year that he died, he helped sell over $1 million worth of windows. Recently this year, we joined together with about 20 organizations around the country that represent people in the front line, people in frontline communities, grassroots organizations, and we created a network to disperse investment, not just where we can reach, but where all of these frontline communities can reach. Together, this peer network can scale 10 to 100 times what we've been able to do so far. But what does all this have to do with SOCAP? What does all this people control have to do with this room of impact investing? Well, if there's one thing that defines our current system more than anything else, there's one thing that governs our current system more than any other force, it's finance. In our current system, we have record corporate profits, and yet a record share of those corporate profits. 40% of all profits in our country are going to finance. It is the most powerful force in the world, which makes this room perhaps one of the most powerful rooms as an agent of change, a room full of people interested in changing the nature of capital, changing the nature of finance. This room has the power to bring that tool of capital to those people. So there's no really soft way to say what the role that capital plays in our system. Essentially, people, our communities, and the planet on which we live are tools for the profit of capital. The system we're building with people on the ground, in that system, capital is the tool. It's a bright, shiny, powerful, wonderful tool, but it is a tool in the hands of those people who use it to meet their community needs and to solve the problems of a global system. In the last year alone, the working world has moved a few million dollars into the hands of grassroots organizations who are pragmatically employing it effectively to solve their problems. But this is just scratching the surface. With a room like this, we might really be able to make a dent and move towards that next system that Gar is talking about. Thank you very much.
That's great. Great. Perfect. Let me introduce Aaron Tanaka, Director of the Center for Economic Democracy and the Boston Impact Initiative.
Is this on? Okay. Very happy to be here with all of you. This is my first SOCAP. It's a
shiny, beautiful-looking room, and to be up here with friends and colleagues is a great honor. I'm here from Boston, and over the last 3 years have been working as the first managing director for the Boston Impact Initiative, which is a place-based private impact investment fund. We started off as a small pilot, $5 million fund, and have been making equity investments and doing loans and giving grants to small businesses and cooperatives in Boston. And in particular, have been interested in innovating around what we as private investors can do with this capital to really leverage and build community power, as was spoken about earlier. And one of the exciting things that we've been doing is using experimenting with a strategy of making private equity investments, but then selling our shares to workers as one of our exit strategies, as another way of using finance capital to build employee ownership and control. Before I started working at the Boston Impact Initiative, though, I was a community organizer. I was the executive director of the Boston Workers Alliance for 7 years, which is a grassroots movement-building organization that represents low-income residents, particularly people of color, people who are unemployed, and specifically, as Angela was speaking about, people who are coming out of prison and have barriers to employment. And in that work, I became truly dedicated to the question of how do we not only deal with broad-based inequality in this country, but specifically working with those in communities that are already marginalized, who are even at the edges of those communities themselves, people who are homeless, people coming out of prison, folks who aren't able to get a foothold in the real economy. And in that work, one of the major things that I started to learn about was the connection between global capital, the transfer and the globalization of capital, the subsequent exportation of labor, and the way in which that exportation of labor from this country has made a broad group of people, particularly black Americans, particularly young men of color, no longer necessary for the functioning of this economy, and how the criminal justice system has been built for the first time over the last 40, 50 years to maintain a system of white supremacy in this country and to control a new group of unemployed workers. And so as we were working in the Boston Workers Alliance to work against discrimination and pass policies like Ban the Box in Massachusetts, we also started asking the question, how can we start creating jobs, worker-owned cooperatives that are run by, owned by people of color, and specifically folks coming out of prison? And we started building cooperatives. This was very, very difficult, as some of you know, and the first co-op that we built was a veggie oil recycling company that unfortunately failed after about 5 months of operations. But we got the bug and started believing in the possibility of entrepreneurship and capital and the need for capital. And so as I moved over to the Boston Impact Initiative, was able to make the first loan to a 2.0 version of this cooperative called Cero. We were able to give a $20,000 zero interest loan to a business that had no collateral, people had no personal assets, and there were no sales. But because it was so mission aligned, we decided to make this loan. And Cero worker owners, folks who are part of my former organization, then went on to raise $17,000 out of an Indiegogo campaign. They used that money then to pay for the legal fees to launch a direct public offering, where then, over the course of a year, we're able to raise $350,000 selling small shares of equity to members in the community. From there now, I'm working currently with Brendan to actually structure another loan in which we'll be able to give them $300,000 for them to fully capitalize and launch our business as an organic composting company. This speaks to me what some of the possibilities that are available to us as private investors as we start to think out of the box and ask ourselves what role we're playing in the broader ecosystem to help leverage and engage community members to help determine their own economic destiny. And at the same time, I've started to ask the question, although I see the benefits and the possibilities of what we can do with private capital, through our new organization, the Center for Economic Democracy, have been asking the question, is that enough? And this is something that I want to raise to you all. And this might not be super popular, but as one fund manager to many others, in the community organizing world, we have an ethic that says our goal and our job is to put ourselves out of work. That is, if we're doing strong leadership development, we're helping build transformative policies, that the role of professional community organizers shouldn't be necessary, and in fact, communities can take that role and build their own power. I want to ask the question to us, as people who are playing this role in finance capital, what is our conception of our direction? What is our ethics as people who control all the capital that Brendan is talking about? It's my belief that we have the possibility to be transformative in our terms, and this is something that many of us are talking about, but I also want to raise the question, what role are we playing in democratizing the decision-making to set those terms in the first place? Right now, I think many of us think of ourselves as benevolent, almost philanthropists who are using favorable, low-interest terms to help spark economic development. However, in Boston, with the Center for Economic Democracy, we're starting to raise the question of what does it look like to give everyday people the power to make decisions on the allocation of their own finance capital. We're taking this question of how do you take participatory budgeting, which has been a process that's been used across the world to allocate municipal tax dollars, and instead start to apply this very same process, where we say we believe in your capacity to make good decisions and believe in the truth that you know what's best for your own community. And from that standpoint, our goal and our question for ourselves is how do we devolve our power so that communities can make those same decisions? I often say that if you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. I hope that together this week, that we decide that we're moving towards the collective liberation of all people. And through this week and the conversations we have, we build that path together. Thank you.
Great. Awesome.
Nice.
And last is Michelle Long, who my good friend, the director of Bali. Michelle.
Well, I feel so excited now. I'm not really a morning person, you know. I just saw a poem, but you guys got me woke up, you know. I mean, I just saw a morning poem recently, and it said, coffee, 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 coffee. Everybody shut up, coffee. And I thought, that was me. But now I feel good. So I'm the sum it up speaker. I'm the bring it home. What couple of points here? We're hearing that the system's broken. I think we all know that. The system's broken. A new one is being called for. A new one's being born. The thing is, systems don't change overnight. It's not like we went to bed yesterday with one system and wake up tomorrow with the next. There's always sparks of the emerging future that are amongst us here now. At Bali, our role is to accelerate the emergence of this kind of economy that serves life. So we find those sparks, connect them with each other. Because they're always fighting an old system while trying to create what's next, and it's really hard. We resource them, nourish them, then we tell their stories so others can see a path to follow, do it through fellowship programs, communities of practice. But there's three points I would share now. The first is what has already been highlighted. The next system, the one we're moving toward, must fundamentally recognize that the path we've been on of building big transnational corporations has done a really effective job at funneling wealth into very few hands. But the data is very clear now. The best path to the most jobs and the most wealth for the most people is directly correlated to the density and diversity of local ownership per place. The second thing I would say is the public markets are unhealthy. We're having unhealthy results from the public markets. There's a study done by the International Labor Organization looking at 71 countries, and they looked at what were the biggest corollaries to inequality in a society. And they looked at the offshoring of production. They looked at mechanization of jobs. They looked at the suppression of minimum wages. But what they found to be the number one corollary was how much what they called financialization, or they also called it how much Wall Street activity was in that economy. That's important to know. It doesn't have to be that way. In Quebec, for instance, they, 30 years ago, took their pension funds and started to invest them in local companies, in regional companies. And they have estimated that they took it out of Wall Street, started investing in their own community, and they estimate that in that time, they have created almost 90,000 new jobs and kept 85,000 jobs, people, households, from having to move away. But the Pope said something recently about we've got a lot of problems. You know, we've got a lot of things we need to fix, but most of all, we need to fix ourselves. And so that'd be the third point I'd make. One of the people that we work with is one of, in our local economy fellowship program, works in New Orleans. And there, 52% of African-American men are unemployed. And for all of the reasons that Angela named, related to institutional racism, historic and current, and the number one employer of African-American people in this country are other African-American people. She's working with lots of African-American small businesses, and this is just one example. A lot of little plumbing companies, and there was going to be a big new airport coming. There's going to be some new hotels coming. She was getting them licensed and bonded and ready and able to access more investment and growth, and they had promises that they were going to be able to have these jobs. And then in the last minute, somebody inside the city had a friend he got his Harvard MBA with and outsourced that whole plumbing contract to somebody who doesn't even live in that town, and that happens all the time. You know, the kind of transformation of the system that we need? Somebody said to me once, when some people talk about transformation, they mean vanilla to vanilla bean. And I mean vanilla to chocolate. And she said, but what we really need is vanilla to music. You know, that's the kind of transformation that we need right now. And I've heard the past few years of people talking about, quoting Einstein's maxim, no problem can be solved from the same level of consciousness that created it. That what we actually need and what's been called for is an evolution in our consciousness and how we are with each other. And the evolution that we need right now is the ability, every era has a kind of leadership that's necessary. And the one today to solve the complex crises of today, like climate change and inequality, we can't do that, me versus you. That's what works for all of us, including me. It's the ability to act from interdependence, to see and feel and act from interdependence. And that can be cultivated. I'm going to actually share with you guys. I had an epiphany at SOCAP 2 years ago, and so I appreciate that. But it was, I don't know what you're going to think of it, but I started to realize that a lot of the things I've been working on for 15 years, local food systems, community energy, community investing, were becoming a bit trendy. And I started to realize people were competing with each other here to save the world. I actually saw people sort of jostling with each other, you know, I'm going to be the top of the green building pile. I'm going to crush the food market. I'm going to own the cooperative market and dominate the love economy. And I was like, wow, well, you know, we're not going to get anything different then. And the people that I've known who've been the innovators loved something. They loved people. They loved place. They loved land. They loved animals. And from that place, they innovated. And we can see what happens, you know, when microfinance or free-range chicken, you know, when it comes into the wrong hands, if you're not motivated from that place of caring, if you're just going by the letter of the law of the free-range chicken, you can do horrific things to animals and land and people and farmers in the name of that, if you're not coming and motivated from that place of caring for each other. So you may say, well, that's all idealistic, Michelle. You know, we're not caring people. But in fact, we are. We are. In fact, we are. You know, the Greater Good Science Center has done research the past 20 years, and others have too, that, you know, for a long time we just looked at depression. What makes people sad? But we started to look, what makes people well? And as it turns out, all people, regardless of demographic, four things make us all well. We feel well deeply inside, deep wellness, when we feel meaning in our lives and purpose. Everybody has a purpose. Everybody's here for a reason. Everybody has a gift to give. We feel well when we feel that. We feel well when we feel deeply connected in relationship with each other. We feel well when we feel an awesome, reverent connection to the larger natural world. Like, I can't believe that tomato plant gave me a tomato. How does it even work? You know, when you feel that awe. And we feel well when we've been compassionate. When we see suffering and we meet it with love, we all feel good after that. That is who we are. You know, the study, so interdependence is who we are. That's who we are deep inside. And so we want what we need, which is really awesome. They've done studies that show that little babies... Oh, I'm over time. Okay, I just realized. Okay. No, I can't. I can't go over time. I will just say, join me. It is, in fact, the largest peaceable land transfer that's ever happened in history happened from Vinoba in India, who was one of Gandhi's disciples, who he just walked door to door and asked people who had a lot of land. He said, hey, brother, these people have no way to grow food. Could you give them a few acres? And they did. You know, that is actually who we are. So let's go for that. And that's all I have time to say.
Thank you. So thank you all. Join us. We'll see you building the next system together. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Don't we love this passion that we have coming at us? This is amazing. We're going to take a little mental break, and I'm going to welcome to the stage a dear friend of mine, a guest artist this year, Chuck Cannon, who Kevin and I heard singing kind of randomly, and actually heard him singing the song he is about to sing for us now. And when I heard it, it was like, this guy has got to be at SOCAP. That was 6 years ago, and we finally got the schedule to work for Chuck to come and be with us. So please welcome to the stage Chuck Cannon.
Wow, there's a lot more of you today than there was yesterday. So make me feel welcome. There you go, like that. Trying to make money takes most of our lives. And it's been known to make husbands strangers to wives. Until his kids don't recognize him when he comes through the door. It's enough to make you wish money don't matter no more. And she's got a minimum wage job for 30 hours a week. Yeah, and her man, well, he left her with three hungry mouths she's got to feed. So she's stealing some milk from the grocery store. It'll make you wish money don't matter no more. We're all underpaid and we're all overwhelmed. Oh, how I wish love was the coin of the realm, where everyone's rich, oh, when nobody's poor. Yes, yeah, sometimes I wish money don't matter no more. How about y'all? Now listen, you can make it the measure of how much you're worth. Oh, and you can store up your treasures down here on earth. You can buy you a big boat that won't sail heaven's sweet shore. That safe harbor where the money don't matter no more. We're all underpaid and we're all overwhelmed. Oh, how I wish love was the coin of the realm, where everyone's rich, oh, when nobody's poor. In the place where the money don't matter no more. Well, 30 pieces of silver was all that it took. To make Judas give Jesus the kiss of the crook. Now that's a hell of a thing to become famous for. Just to find out that the money don't matter no more. We're all underpaid and we're all overwhelmed. Oh, how I wish love was the coin of the realm, where everyone's rich, oh, and nobody's poor. I can't wait until the money don't matter no more. Now the Christians and the Buddhists and the Muslims and Jews and the atheists, the agnostic, the Rastafarian, the Zoroastrian, the Presbyterian, the Confucian, Southern Baptists, Pentecostals, Episcopalians, and even Sikhs and Hindus. The doctor, the lawyer, the preacher, the whore. Guess what? We're all gonna end up where the money don't matter no more. We're all underpaid and we're all overwhelmed. Oh, how I wish love was the coin of the realm, where everyone's rich, oh, when nobody's poor. When we all get where the money don't matter no more. Thank y'all so much. Have fun today.
Thank you, Chuck. If you want to hear a little bit more of his music, just be in every plenary session. He'll be back with us. And also at 2:30 in the firehouse, he and I are going to have a conversation about money and music. So come join us. One quick little housekeeping detail. Just stop looking at your watches. We're running over. We're going to be late. And it's all taken care of. So don't get up and leave early to go to the next session. The next session will be waiting for you when you get to it. So we're going to move on quickly through the rest of the program, but just sit back and relax. We have some great programming coming in the second half of this session. So, Tim Freundlich, you're on.
Hey. Hello. Good morning. I have a great pleasure of just giving you a minute or less on Lisa Hall, who's going to be our next speaker. Lisa and I kind of go pretty far way back. We spent a few lovely years at Calvert Foundation helping to build it. First, she was the CIO and then became the CEO. But she's since moved on to an amazing new gig in Europe with the Brinkenmeyer family. And she's running the Anthos Capital Unit and also the Scopos Impact Fund. The Brinkenmeyer family is it's actually an impact investment arm of the family office that does the CNA retail chain is the privately held organization that the family works with. And she has, she's really been digging in deep with Wharton recently, and I know she's gonna share some of the findings there on some research around impact measurement, which is super critical for the field. But mostly, I just want you to join me in welcoming Lisa. She's a woman of great integrity and long commitment to the field, and just a wonderful organizational builder. Lisa.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Tim, for those incredibly kind words. When Tim first conceived of SOCAP back in 2007, I could not have imagined more than 2,500 social investors and social entrepreneurs under one tent in it, from all over the globe. It's really incredible. And when Tim and I, back in 2007, were much younger, not nearly so wise, and if I recall correctly, my hair was a little bit shorter, and Tim's was not nearly as, or was more full than it is now. thank you, Tim. Thank you, Rosalie, Penelope, and all the other principals for Mission Hub. You all deserve our gratitude, and one more round of applause, I think. Look at this amazing crowd. I'm truly humbled to be here today. And as Tim mentioned, for the past 2 years, I've been living and working abroad. And it is so good to be home. And while it's always great to be back visiting in the United States, it's not exactly what I mean when I say it feels good to be home. Some call it their North Star. Others, their true north. For me, being here at this extraordinary conference, in this community of like-minded souls, of fellow travelers on the social capital journey, it feels like home. So I want to ask you all a question while I'm here, back home. What and who are you waiting for? What is your true north? 5 years ago, I stood in the Cal Theater when SOCAP was a much, much smaller crowd. And I stood before the crowd and said, "We are the ones we've been waiting for." And most of you know that's not an original line. It's inspired by Barack Obama, who himself was inspired by a poem for South African women by June Jordan. 5 years ago, impact investing was also in its infancy, and there was not clarity about what to call it. There were lots of terms for it. And frankly, I don't care what we call it. What I care about is what we do as individuals, as organizations, as institutions. If 5 years ago there was a lack of clarity, which there was, about what we call what we do, then today there's even greater lack of consensus about how do we define it. But let's not be distracted by these conversations of what to call it and how to define it. Let's focus as a community on the doing, on the impact investing. Most of us started with the idea of a big tent. And I've always been an advocate of a big tent. Lots of market participants welcome at the table of impact investing. But I had no idea how big the tent would get. And it keeps getting even bigger. A big tent can be a great thing. More people and more organizations under the tent brings increased sophistication and structuring as we begin to collaborate in areas like impact measurement and research. In the 2015 Gin JP Morgan study, led by Yasmin Saltik, 9 out of 10 investors said co-investors were key to their decision making. I urge us all to collaborate as much as possible. Part of demonstrating proof of concept for us as a sector in our ability to collaborate is evidenced by investment platforms like Tonic, led by Stephanie Cohn-Rupp. More people and more organizations under the tent also brings with it more complexity, more scrutiny, including more regulation. So let's be careful as an impact investing community not to overstructure, not to over-engineer. Let's not complicate it if it's not necessary. And let's be sure to match appropriate capital with the actual financing needs of the people that we're trying to serve. No matter where you sit in the tent, I still ask you, who are you waiting for? If it was true 5 years ago, it is even more true today, in 2015. We, all of us, are the ones that we've been waiting for. And I love this picture of leaders from the field because it reflects the diversity of our sector. In this picture, there are people of different races. There are people of different religions. There are people of different countries of origin. And I think my favorite thing about this picture is that there are men and there are women. And we as a community are not serving the traditional power base. The people that we are trying to give access to capital don't look like the traditional power base, and we shouldn't either. We have to include everyone under the tent, people and professions that are different from ourselves. We must do better, we must be better than the traditional power base about inclusion if we want to serve those without access. Impact investing is on the path to mainstream. Even the Pope is talking about it, as we just heard. And it's because of that diversity, not in spite of it, that we're on the path to mainstream. The evidence includes the engagement of family offices like Anthos, where I am blessed to lead the Impact Investing Initiative for one of the largest family offices in the world. And if that isn't mainstream, I don't know what is. Last year at Anthos, we launched the Scopos Impact Fund. In the past 2 years, we have made capital commitments to 6 fund managers and 1 direct investment in a portfolio company. These funds span the range of asset classes. Some are originating debt, some private equity, and some are doing both. And we are not alone in our view that there's a spectrum of impact investing, a spectrum that has been long heralded by investors like FB Heron Foundation, led by Clara Miller. At Anthos, we have an incredible team. And we are not just making investments. We also want to help the field of impact investing to scale by sponsoring research and by doing field building work. We started off by sponsoring work on liquidity and exits. And we're thrilled today, we're so excited to be able to announce the release of a new paper entitled Great Expectations, published by the Wharton School at University of Pennsylvania. I think a lot of people are actually going to talk about this study, and it already has received coverage in the Wall Street Journal, which you can find on today's online edition. The study says that in a certain segment of impact investing, market rate returns can be achieved. We started off simply wanting to know, can you get exits in impact investing? And when you exit, is mission preserved over time? And the answer turns out to be an unqualified yes, you can. These results do not mean that there's never a trade-off between mission and return. And as practitioners in the field, many of us know that the segment of the market that's trying to serve the poorest, that's trying to reach the hardest to reach, there will always be subsidy required. And sometimes that comes in the form of lower returns. And frankly, that's okay. We should be okay with that as a community. But sometimes there is not a trade-off. And I'm not sure why it's such a controversial idea that we could generate market rate returns. The idea of segmentation is one that's being researched right now in partnership with Case at Duke under the leadership of Kathy Clark. There are many segments in other capital markets and asset classes, fixed income as an example, where there's a range of risk and return from govies to corporates to high yield, and nobody complains about that. The research from Wharton tells us that in some segments of the market, it is possible to have both financial and social returns. And we think that's a great thing, because only when we can demonstrate market returns will institutional investors bring large sums of capital to the table. The Wharton Social Impact Initiative conducted this research under the supervision of the chairman of the finance department, Professor David Musto. And Scopus was pleased to be one of the funding partners for the new report. To borrow from the World Economic Forum and the work led by Abigail Noble in her prior role, impact investing is finally moving from the margins to mainstream. An objective, top-tier, globally renowned business school like Wharton, which also happens to be one of my alma maters, they're weighing in affirmatively on impact investing. And if that's not moving into mainstream, I don't know what is. There are representatives at both exits of the room with hard copies of the report, which we urge you to read. Also come to tomorrow's panel, where Dr. Gessi and my colleague Dimple Sani from Scopus will be talking about the findings of the report in detail. So I'm coming to the end of my remarks, and I've saved the best for last. Because our work at Scopus Impact Fund is about generating social and environmental outcomes. Our impact areas are outlined here, and we've invested a lot of time and energy and resources to developing a custom impact measurement framework. Our framework is an impact measurement tool developed in partnership with Bridges Impact, led by Clara Barbie. This tool will allow us to be both specific and to be measurable about our impact intentions. In closing, I want to remind us all that we are the ones that we've been waiting for. I look out on this incredible crowd. I'm so glad to be back home, and I'm confident that no matter how large the task ahead may be, that together, like this determined woman on her bicycle, we not only can, we will. And for myself, like these smiling girls so filled with gratitude that remind me of a time when both Tim and I were much younger and not nearly so wise, I too am grateful for your time and attention today. Thank you.
Lisa just kicked us off with the first of three talks that I think really highlight this unique moment that we're in here. The tent's getting bigger, we're getting smarter about what works, and if you look around, we're all here together, which is really amazing. So the silos come down at SOCAP, and these next two talks really show that. We've seen increased participation from government and international development sectors over the last few years, and USAID has been an amazing partner to SOCAP. I'm excited to bring to the stage Anne Mae Chang, who's the Executive Director of the U.S. Global Development Lab at USAID. She's a picture of cross-sector participation. She's worked in the international NGO sector, in the corporate sector, and now in government. I'm really excited to hear her remarks, and I want to welcome Anne Mae.
Good morning. Last week, I was in New York City, where leaders from around the world, 193 of them, came together at the UN General Assembly to adopt a new ambitious vision for the world's future, the Sustainable Development Goals. Actually, do I have a clicker for my slides? I don't see a first slides. Sorry about that. So these 193 leaders came together to adopt the Sustainable Development Goals. Sorry. And for the first time in the world's history, I believe we are within reach of the overarching goal, which is to end extreme poverty by 2030. Social entrepreneurs are vital to achieving this goal of ending extreme poverty. They drive economic growth by using market-based approaches to address issues around poverty. But as important as entrepreneurs have been in driving growth and innovation in the United States, they're even more essential in developing countries, where there's almost a billion youth who are either unemployed or underemployed. In low-income countries, small and medium enterprises contribute 78% of full-time employment. as compared to 66% in high-income countries. And every dollar invested in a small and growing business, on average, generates more than $13 in the local economy through the benefits to suppliers, customers, and employees. Of course, in addition to generating economic growth, social enterprises generate social impact by providing poor customers with access to essential goods and services that are normally out of their reach, whether it's clean water, energy, healthcare, education, or financial services. The U.S. Global Development Lab is the newest bureau at USAID, which is the U.S. government's international development agency. We launched the Global Development Lab a year ago, April, to use science, technology, innovation, and partnerships to transform international development by identifying faster, better, cheaper, and more sustainable solutions. We do so by casting as wide a net as possible to find the best ideas for innovations, tools, and approaches that are disruptive. And then we use hard data and fast iteration to develop the most promising ones. And finally, we work across USAID and our partners to mainstream proven solutions. The lab is proud to be a part of President Obama's Spark initiative to bring $1 billion of new investment to the next generation of entrepreneurs around the world. USAID itself has invested over $900 million to benefit social entrepreneurs in developing countries. And there's three areas that the lab works in that I'll talk about. First of all, the lab invests directly in entrepreneurs themselves. We believe that donor support is essential to being catalytic to help these early-stage entrepreneurs get off the ground, refine their models, and get to the point where they can attract commercial investment. For example, through our Development Innovation Ventures Program, or DIV, we provide an initial $100,000 seed grant to Off-Grid Electric in Tanzania. This enabled them to supply their first 1,000 customers with clean, affordable, and accessible solar energy. Based on their success, we followed on with a $1 million grant. These grants enabled the entrepreneurs to refine their business models, prove their capabilities and social impact, and gain customer traction. Based on that, Off-Grid was able to leverage this lab's initial investment to raise $16 million in private equity and an additional $7 million from IFC. And I'm pleased to report that as of July, more than 50,000 households in Tanzania now have access to electricity because of Off-Grid Electric. The second area that the lab works in is that we partner with investors, accelerators, and intermediaries that support the broader entrepreneurial ecosystems. It's clear that funding alone is not the only challenge for small and growing businesses. They often lack talent management and business development capabilities that are needed to grow. So our Partnering to Accelerate Entrepreneurship Initiative, or PACE, works with intermediaries to address these challenges faced by small and growing businesses by providing access to acceleration services and blended financing. As of June, the 35 direct investments we've made in PACE have generated 7,000 new jobs, earned $15 million in new revenues, and raised $30 million in additional capital. Finally, the third area that we work in is to generate additional research in understanding entrepreneurial ecosystems, to understand which interventions are actually effective to helping entrepreneurs succeed. For example, there's been this rapid growth of accelerators, incubators, and tech hubs across developing countries, as you see here on the map. But do they work? Do they actually help entrepreneurs succeed? I'm not sure. Some do and probably some don't. We hope to answer these questions through the Global Accelerator Learning Initiative, or GALI, where we're partnering with the Aspen Network for Development Entrepreneurs and Emory University, funded through the Lab, Amidyar Network, Lemison Foundation, and Ergidius Foundation. GALI is going to collect data on more than 10,000 global firms to study questions such as, whether accelerators actually do accelerate growth of early stage ventures, and which accelerators had the biggest impact on entrepreneurial success. By identifying the factors that most contribute to success, we hope to be able to better target our future investments. So we're really proud of the work we've done, and yet we realize that there are so many more challenges ahead. One of those challenges I want to talk about is that, as all of you here know today, more and more of the best solutions are hybrid ones, which are not either pure nonprofits, nor are they pure for-profits. And thus, they usually need to draw from a complicated mix of grant funding, impact funding, and private sector funding. The problem with this is that the vast majority of available funding is either pure philanthropic funding or pure commercial funding. So of the estimated funding that is aligned with the new global goals, commercial funding is about 10 times as much as the size of philanthropic funding, which in turn is about 10 times the size of impact funds. And of that tiny slice of impact funds, we believe that only about 18% of it is truly concessionary. This means that an infinitesimal portion of the available funding even attempts to address the hybrid funding needs of social enterprises. I believe that truly concessionary impact funds will always be a challenge. Just from my personal experience, I give to charities on one hand. On the other hand, I invest for my retirement. And I have to admit, I get a little queasy when I think about taking my retirement money and putting it up as first loss capital for a social enterprise. I may be a heretic here for saying this, but I'm just not convinced that truly concessionary impact funding that is needed will grow fast enough to meet the growing needs. Today, when we have a social enterprise that earns revenues, but not sufficient revenues to meet the expectation of private sector returns, we mostly bridge this gap through one-off solutions, putting together custom funding stacks that mix grant funding, impact investment, and commercial funds. It takes a lot of work, and it takes a lot of time. How many of you guys have seen that happen? So, is there another way? What if we were able to create a market by actually paying for social outcomes, where the social value of a business is externalized, whether it be $20 or $2? Think about this similar to the way carbon credits externalize the environmental cost to the business. Instead, the social value becomes simply another reliable revenue stream to the social entrepreneur, and the social enterprise can then operate like a normal private sector business and draw funding from normal private sector debt and capital sources. So for donors, what this would mean is creating a stable market by playing for social value rather than deploying traditional programs. The advantage? We only pay if the results we're looking for are achieved. For social entrepreneurs, what this would mean is tapping into the far more significant commercial funding sources based on their ability to compete in this hybrid market. And for private investors, this would enable them to invest in the full range of social enterprises that are out there and be able to draw market rate returns. So this isn't a new idea. Social impact bonds and development impact bonds have started to explore this space, but it's still incredibly rare. This is just one approach, but I believe we need to accelerate our progress by, one, effectively measuring social impact so it can be securitized in ways like this, and two, standardizing hybrid financial instruments that make it much easier and much more flexible to access. We don't purport to have all the solutions, and what we want to do is we're here because we want to work with all of you to find better, more effective ways to support social entrepreneurs who we believe really play an essential role in meeting global goals. I'm really encouraged by the increased collaboration we're seeing between investors, entrepreneurs, and development sector actors, such as ourselves at USAID. And I'm grateful for Kevin Jones and SOCAP team for bringing us all here together again today. Really look forward to continuing the important collaboration with all of you. Thank you so much.
So as we've heard from Lisa and Anne May, family offices and government are making big new commitments to this field, to impact investing and to social entrepreneurship. Investing in the most promising social entrepreneurs, both for-profit and nonprofit, is critical to growing this field. Echoing Green has been doing this work for over 25 years, and what I love about this organization is that they continue to innovate and learn and build on what they hear from their fellows to continue to support more entrepreneurs in new issue areas and to bring more people into their work so that they're connecting these fellows to folks that will support their work for years to come. So I'm really excited to hear the latest from the president of Echoing Green, Cheryl Dorsey, and help us figure out how we can support all the entrepreneurs at SOCAP, all the entrepreneurs that they're connected to, all the entrepreneurs that you know at home, and really grow the field. Cheryl Dorsey.
Thank you, Lindsay. Good morning, everybody. Okay, we got to do that again. Good morning. Great. Thank you so much. I'm absolutely thrilled and honored to be with you all. I'm also incredibly honored to have followed such fierce leaders like Lisa Hall and Anne Mae Chang. So I'm super excited to spend the next 12 or so minutes with you guys. Another shout out to SOCAP for having us. SOCAP has long been a great friend to Echoing Green, and we're really excited to be an innovation partner for this year's conference. So by my count, there are about 50 or so Echoing Green fellows, alums, and staff coursing their way through SOCAP this year. So for all of you out there, it's going to be hard not to stumble across, bump into, or connect with someone from the community. And I really encourage you, take some time, hang out, get to know them, worth engaging in these conversations and forging some terrific relationships. I know I look forward to it. So, as Lindsay mentioned, I run Echoing Green. Echoing Green has been around for a long time, about 30 years. Echoing Green created a new model for funding and supporting early stage social entrepreneurs and has become the premier leadership accelerator for finding talent and unleashing it for the social good. We do this in a couple of ways. We first find rare and exceptional next-gen global leadership. We build and sustain a community of social innovators. We accelerate these leaders to impact the world. And we mine the insights, the lessons, approaches, and challenges faced by these leaders and create new programming to support a more robust social innovation ecosystem. So to date, Echoing Green has supported about 700 social entrepreneurs who've worked in more than 70 countries around the world. They've leveraged our seed funding and gone on to raise in excess of $5 billion in additional funding for the public good, impacting positively millions of lives. So, you know, I was about to say that it's a really interesting time for Echoing Green, but as you all know, it's always a really interesting time for those of us who work in this space. Nonetheless, I want to walk through a couple of themes that we're seeing from our purview at Echoing Green that I think are worth highlighting and that I believe will give us some sense of where the field, where the social enterprise field is heading. So I'm going to quickly flag five areas. First, getting real is the pioneer gap and impassable gulch, first. Second, the growing role of purpose as part of the double bottom line for companies. Three, connecting the dots and making explicit the connection between social enterprise and equity issues. Four, moving beyond an institutional frame for social impact, talking more about embracing distributed networks and communities of practice. And five, how the inextricable link between talent and value creation in the modern economy could mainstream social impact work. So I'll walk quickly through each of the five. First, is the pioneer gap an impassable gulch? So Echoing Green's impact investing program stems from our long history of seeding, selecting, and supporting social entrepreneurs. In the past decade, we've helped seed the growing momentum around for-profit and hybrid business models. So for example, in 2006, only about 15% of those in our applicant pool were proposing for-profit or hybrid models. In 2015, that had increased to 50%. And, you know, despite compelling research on the pioneer gap and frequent acknowledgement of the lack of seed stage financing for social enterprise, the most promising early stage ventures still face crippling hurdles in accessing capital. You know, we're hearing from a lot of our social entrepreneurs that in addition to individual fundraising challenges, their lack of access to aligned early stage impact capital is a result of systemic structural market problems. Now that they've launched their impact businesses, they feel isolated and far too often adversarial with the impact investors with whom they had hoped to partner. They also recognize that it is not only a disappointment to them, but that impact investors are also having difficulty reaching the goals and milestones that they'd enter the market to achieve. You know, we at Echoing Green are taking a number of approaches to address this. We're working with other funders to provide blended capital, both philanthropy and investment, to catalyze innovative solutions. Second, we're convening social entrepreneurs and investors to discuss, frankly, these issues. And third, we're continuing to provide research to better inform the field. You know, this afternoon, we'll be participating on a panel, Blended Capital to Support Early Stage Entrepreneurs, about this topic. And we actually just released a new white paper in partnership with USAID called Deviation from the Standard to share key learnings about the types of investment readiness support and financing that early stage social entrepreneurs need in developed and emerging markets. So that was pioneer gap. Second, the growing role of purpose as part of the double bottom line for companies. So in 2011, we became one of the first organizations to name and invest in the development of an emerging purpose field when we launched our signature Work on Purpose program with the vision to help young people, mostly young people, make career decisions that are right for them and good for the world. Companies around the world are also using these principles to try to recruit and retain a diverse pipeline of talent. And to do the work we want to do as social entrepreneurs and organizations with a social mission, we need staff as well that are as committed as we. So companies are really listening and are increasingly paying close attention. This generation of millennials who are eager to find meaning and purpose in their lives and work are influencing companies to institute and increase new corporate recruitment and engagement strategies related to purpose. So for example, Ben & Jerry's is testing new ways to champion purpose within their company, including equipping employees to lead and sit in on purpose exploration workshops. We actually hosted one of their workshops last month with Ben & Jerry's staff. They have a purpose team at Ben & Jerry's. So their purpose team, which is a cross-departmental group, is dedicated to determining how the corporation can further instill an emphasis on individual purpose into their work. So today, employees want more, and research shows that there are actually serious benefits to this kind of focus. So for example, employees with a strong sense of purpose are at least 4 times more likely to be engaged in their jobs as other employees. And also, during a time in which workplace engagement in this country is remarkably low, companies that are driven by purpose have employees that are 3 times more likely to stay with that company. Purpose-driven companies also outperform the S&P 500 by 10 times between the years of 1996 and 2011. So purpose. Third point, connecting the dots and making explicit the connection between social enterprise and equity issues. You know, in 2007, I was at a conference similar to this, where I gave a talk tracing many of the predicates of this field to the work of social justice and critical social movements, including the civil rights movement, a human capital development approach and investment in next generation leadership, a focus on opportunity, and leveraging the power of narrative to shift norms and change behaviors widely. So the next generation of social entrepreneurs at Echoing Green are now leading on this front, really digging in on how to think about systemic racial equity in and through the lens of social entrepreneurship. They are smartly examining questions of differential access to networks and the impact this has on financial capital flows, as well as on building the kinds of bonding capital that's critical to achieving lasting social impact. They're looking at inherent biases of funders and what it means to fund otherness, and unpacking frames like culture and fit as too exclusionary for the abundance of talent that's really needed to take on and solve the challenges before us. And over the next couple of days, there are a number of really important panels here that will include some of these social innovators that I really encourage you to check out. There's a panel tomorrow morning called Measuring Racism, the Prerequisite for Diversity and Equity. It will explore ideas from leading racial justice research and begin to assess social entrepreneurship's role in the inequitable power dynamics created by racism. There's another panel on tap this morning called Funding Otherness, the Impact of Race, Culture, Gender, and Other Identities. And on Friday morning, there's a panel called Breaking Down Barriers to Inclusive Organizational Culture. I think these are incredibly important conversations that will allow new spaces and leading innovators to dig in deep on these very important issues. So equity and innovation, the nexus. Four, moving beyond an institutional frame for social impact, embracing distributed networks and communities of practice. I mean, we all know that throughout history, social change has been possible only through the contributions and engagement of both individuals and organizations, connected in both tight and loose groups. Positive developments, disruptive innovation, and scale will all be increasingly linked to ongoing actions through a network of relationships. So what does this mean for a community like Echoing Green? So as our network has grown to be 700-plus social innovators and many friends and supporters, we're beginning to invest heavily in opportunities for collective learning and engagement and facilitating communities of practice by issue area, inflection point, and geography. So for example, next month, we will convene our currently funded fellows and alums in Johannesburg over the course of a week in partnership with USAID. We'll have close to 200 social entrepreneurs with us for peer learning sessions, engagement with local leaders, industry roundtables. And in addition, over the past 2.5 years, we've piloted a cohort model of learning, bringing together small groups of social entrepreneurs confronting similar challenges to then work through those issues together over the span of 15 to 18 months. And thus far, we've hosted about 3 of these cohorts around topics of raising impact investing dollars, scaling your human services delivery model, and scaling your work through idea diffusion. Finally, we're really interested to watch how social innovators themselves are starting to create distributed networks that are organic and dynamic and truly open source. So it's interesting to note that a lot of these networks are really predicated in large measure around human capital development framework. So for example, we're now seeing second order effects where Echoing Green funded enterprises are now seeding next generation talent and networks which are then coming into the Echoing Green space. It's a trend to watch and an important mechanism for social change in the 21st century. Which brings me to my last point. How the inextricable link between talent and value creation in the modern economy could mainstream social impact work. So, you know, while 100 years ago, natural resources were really considered the economy's most valuable assets, talent's rise to become the key asset in the modern economy began about 50 years ago, with an extraordinary flowering of creative work that required substantial independent judgment and decision-making. So while in the for-profit sector, this really drove a focus on compensating talent, and we know some real downsides about overcompensating talent, there's actually been a lag in our sector, in the social sector, around this conversation beyond the concern for the coming talent deficit. There's really an increasing push for next generation talent to engage in social impact work, providing not just an outlet for creative thinking, but also because there's a growing cachet of this type of professional path. And from our perspective, this really offers a real opportunity to double down on this linkage between talent and value creation. Because at the end of the day, that's what we're all here for, value creation socially, economically, and environmentally. And in fact, Echoing Green is presenting the 21st Century Talent Content Track at this year's conference. And today, you'll have the opportunity to hear from 2 of my colleagues, along with other speakers, who will be leading sessions on how to land and retain top talent and answer the question, what does it take to prepare private sector talent for nonprofit board service, for example? These are just some of the trends, some of the themes, some of the conversations we're having in Echoing Green. We'd love to invite you all into that conversation informally over the next couple of days, or if you guys have some free time this evening, we will be at Stock and Trade at 2036 Lombard Street, 5:30 to 7:30 this evening. Come by for some food, for some drinks, some good company. We'd love to continue engaging in this conversation with you, and we appreciate your attention. Thank you.
Thanks, Cheryl. Thanks, Cheryl. So, I mean, that Echoing Green is amazing. It's like 27 years has graduated cohort after cohort through their programs, and I can't think of another entrepreneur network and support system that is as long tenured and successful. Oh, wait, actually, I can. It's Ashoka. Ha! Ashoka. Bill Drayton's been running Ashoka for more than 30 years. They are a global entity on so many cuts. You want to go geography, sector, et cetera, et cetera. They are everywhere. And so we thought it would be amazing to get Bill up here to get into conversation with Eric Branham, who's actually the CEO of Mission Hub, which runs SOCAP and a bunch of impact hubs around the United States, to really go deep on what they are plumbing in terms of learning. So I want to turn it over to Eric Branham and Bill Drayton, and please join me in welcoming them. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you, everyone. I know the question has been asked a number of times in terms of folks' first SOCAP, but again, raise your hand if this is your first SOCAP ever. And it is mine as well. I feel a little bit like Stephen Colbert on The Late Show. I sort of like the new gig. I feel like I need like a band and come out dancing or something like that. But that's amazing. I am thrilled to be here. I joined as CEO of Mission Hub 7 months ago. And I'll talk a little bit about Mission Hub before bringing Bill onto the stage. But, you know, I'm in my mid-40s. And this is the world of impact and social entrepreneurship is relatively new for me. You know, folks in their mid-40s is that classic kind of midlife crisis time. You know, some people find God. I like to think that I found good and get to join you here on stage. So I did start life as a climate scientist. I was a carbon dioxide researcher at Scripps Institution of Oceanography, working in the lab of Dr. David Keeling, and worked on the famous Keeling curve, both in atmospheric and in seawater carbon dioxide. So it has been really fun to move through the technology industry, through the worlds of startups and entrepreneurship, and eventually working on platforms for innovation, which has actually brought me here to Mission Hub. What is Mission Hub, you say? How many of you actually know who Mission Hub is? Actually, there'll be like four people in the audience. Mission Hub, one of our objectives and goals actually here at SOCAP was to talk about Mission Hub and actually raise the awareness of the mission of Mission Hub. We are the parent company of SOCAP. We actually are the a network of campuses, Impact Hub co-working campuses here in the United States. And in your program books, on the sort of the second and third pages, it talks a bit about who Mission Hub is, and we have this notion that SOCAP is really powered by Mission Hub. I view Mission Hub as a marketplace that is building the future of social innovation with you all as parts of that. We are a marketplace of ideas, like the SOCAP conference. We are a marketplace for skills and learning. One of the new programs that we're launching at SOCAP15 is SOCAP 365, which is actually bringing the content, the rich content from this conference, out to our five campuses into weekly programming so that we can inspire and teach the next generation of impact investors and social entrepreneurs. We are a physical marketplace for the goods and services that social entrepreneurs need to launch and grow. Yesterday, Sam Utney, Sam out here, I know he was in the back there. Sam is the managing director of Impact Hub New York City, which is a Mission Hub company, and talked about the Impact Bazaar, which is this physical marketplace for these goods and services. Hey, Brian. Well, Brian Breckenridge from Box.org. Thank you for joining us. We are a marketplace for financial capital. Our Philadelphia campus, we are going to be building a world-leading center of expertise around impact investing and continue to take this amazing fabric that we are weaving together and bring it to market. And lastly, and ultimately, we are a marketplace that transcends place. You may have seen SOCAP TV, which we're launching at SOCAP this year, SOCAP 15, which is recording much of the content and snippets and bringing it online to a worldwide audience so that they can view and interact with what we're doing. So first off, thank you for being here. Thank you for letting me share the stage with you this morning. And I am thrilled to bring onto the stage a man who probably needs no introduction to the vast majority of people in this room, but I will introduce him nonetheless. Bill Drayton is the CEO and founder of Ashoka, Innovators for the Public, whose vision is an everyone a change maker world, where anyone can apply the skills of change making to solve complex social problems. Bill pioneered the field of social entrepreneurship as a Harvard undergrad, as a Yale student at Yale Law School, a management consultant at McKinsey, at the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, and as a MacArthur Fellow. He's taught law and management at Stanford Law School and at Harvard's Kennedy School of Government and serves on the boards of Get America Working and Youth Venture. Please join me in giving a very, very warm SOCAP welcome to Mr. Bill Drayton. Thank you, John. Thank you so much.
Good to see you. Hi.
Good to see you. So we were talking actually before this, Bill, and this is your first SOCAP as well in terms of physically being here, but have interacted and seen some of our great content to date. So thank you for joining us. Bill, you're a lifetime social entrepreneur and have been at the helm of Ashoka since you founded it in 1980. After more than 35 years, what is unique about this moment for Ashoka?
Well, I think everyone here knows the answer to that. We know deeply that we are a transition point, the most amazing transition point ever. That's why SOCAP is so important. It's a key part of that transition. And Ashoka is very privileged to be able to see the patterns because of the 3,000 fellows, because of our many other partners. And in brief summary, the world has been organized for millennia for efficiency and repetition. So think assembly line law firm. But since 1700, the rate of change after being static has been escalating exponentially. That's just a fact. And so a world of giving people a skill which they will then repeat for their life doesn't work anymore. And that way of organizing doesn't work anymore. Instead, we are living in a world of change, which is the opposite of repetition. And we have to organize differently, and everyone has to have different skills. So seeing this and realizing that we're at the turning point, I think we all, everyone here, has a responsibility to help the world through that transition. And the key part is helping people see it. Once you see it, then you know what to do, especially when the people around you also see it. So it's a frame change moment, and thank you to SOCAP and everyone here for being a key part of that.
Thank you. You mentioned, Bill, the scale of the Ashoka Fellows Program, 3,300 fellows across 85 countries. With now an organization of that scale and size, what are some of the patterns that you're seeing to emerge from the fellows themselves?
Well, I've just mentioned the most important one, but first of all, let me introduce who the fellows are. over half of them have changed national policy within 5 years of launch, and three quarters the pattern in the field. So these are extraordinary people, organizations, and movements, and we would be blind if we didn't see the patterns. And that is really, really important. It's not only seeing where we're going, but how to get there. And so let me just give you an example. The largest single group of Ashoka Fellows focuses on children and young people, which is probably true for everyone here in our personal lives. And there's an extremely obvious pattern. 95% of them put kids in charge, which is not what the schools do. It's not what most parents do. It's a very different model. They're also, you can see that pattern in another way, because over 80% of the Ashoka Fellows started something when they were in their teens, or usually early teens. And so if I just summarize this pattern, you can see immediately how it fits a world where everyone has to be a change maker. The new definition of success in growing up, and therefore education, is every young child must master empathy and guide their lives by that. And then when they become a young person around 12, they have to practice and practice being a change maker. Now, what I've just said is coming from the reality of a world where everything's changing and where you need everyone to be a change maker, any young person who doesn't have these skills is not going to make it. Any society, any city, any group that doesn't make sure that this generation of children and young people have those skills is in deep, deep, and fast trouble. So that is a, this is like just a, this is like 100 years ago saying we needed everyone to be literate in written language. We needed people to read street signs and manuals. No one's ever agreed about how to do that, but that's just a fact. And we're now at a moment where these other skills, cognitive empathy, sophisticated teamwork, a completely opposite type of leadership and change making is necessary. So that is a pattern. And the final point about it is it fits the everyone a change maker world. And you can see that in field after field. The fellows dealing with health, put patients, friends, family, neighbors, peers in charge. Oh, that fits. So,
okay. As a part of that, as Ashoka shifted from just supporting individual entrepreneurs to this notion of the world, right? Everyone a change maker. How did that open up new possibilities for Ashoka as an organization, the way that you were organized?
So, we've historically been organized as a series of individual entrepreneurs with a team. Finding the best ideas, entrepreneurs, helping them get started, building a community in Nigeria or Poland or whatever. When you have to take on, how are we going to change the framework of thinking, for example, about growing up? Well, then all the pieces have to work together. We have to become a fluid, open team of teams just as much as everyone else. And that's a very different way of organizing. Over the last, I'd say, couple of years, we've learned something very profoundly powerful, which is collaborative entrepreneurship jiu-jitsu. So, okay, we see this new pattern. Every young person must practice and practice being a change maker. And that means that schools have to be, in everyone, a change maker culture. Well, how do we, and that fits the everyone a change maker world. You have to do that. Well, then how do we get people to see it? Well, entrepreneurs are always a small force tipping the system. How do we do that together? And so this is amazing. But we're actually succeeding at this. And there are four stages. The first is the trigger. What's the least number of forces you need to set in motion that will create a self-multiplying dynamic? Leadership teams in a few schools, a few writers and publishers, and leadership from some fellows. That has already led in the US to 12 graduate schools of education, to ministers of education. We're looking to bring on teachers' unions. Wholesale partners have to pick up in the next stage, and you have to make it open. The third stage, once millions of people see it and are talking and it's the subject of conversation, how do you make sure that the conversation is as sharply focused, as intelligent as possible? How do you provide the flow of anecdotes? And then finally, institutionalization. That's a completely new thing, and it's incredibly powerful. And in a world where you have to have fluid, open teams of teams, this is a really important one. Whenever there's a critical mass of social entrepreneurs, entrepreneurs bringing major change for the good of all, they need to be able to get together to be as powerful as possible. And that's what collaborative entrepreneurship jiu-jitsu does.
One of the things we talked about before coming up is talking about that 12-year-old. So I have three kids, an 8-year-old boy, a 10-year-old girl, and a 12-year-old, 10-year-old girl, and a 12-year-old girl, who are super fun and amazing. What is your message to my 12-year-old daughter, Sophie, who's out there trying to find her own sort of identity in the universe? And frankly, part of my motivation of coming into this role is trying to be an inspiring person for her and to engage her with this universe of change. What is your message to Sophie?
Well, given this framework change, we have something called Ashoka's Youth Venture. And the goal is to help any young person anywhere have their own dream, build their own team, and change their school or neighborhood. Anyone who's done that has... They are a change maker. So let me tell you a story that I found very powerful. We had a meeting of about 350 U.S. youth venturers. I sit down at lunch, and this very tiny young woman comes down and sits to my right. So I turn to her, and she introduces herself and says, I'm 12, because she's sick of people thinking she's 8, probably. And so I asked her, well, what's your venture? And she said, oh, well, my brother's autistic. And all through school, I would cry when he was mistreated. But now we fix that. Oh, well, how did you do that? Well, we get together whenever we see a special student not being treated well, and we figure out what to do, and then we go and do it, and we're very persistent. Now, that's 90% her words, word for word. And if you were there, you would not have one cell of doubt that she is a change maker, that she knows it, that she's never going to be afraid in her life, and she's going to get better and better at this. She is able to express love and respect in action in a powerful way, and she knows it. She's also brought a whole bunch of kids along with her. She has her PhD, and the most important skill she has to have to contribute in a world of change. There is huge demand for people with those skills. The people in this room don't understand, because we all have that gift, what it's like not to have it. It's terrifying. It's the worst. Now, I asked her one other question. How many student groups are there in Shirley Middle School, which is a poor rural school which has flight of talent from the community as fast as possible? It's an Appalachian-like environment. Oh, over 50. Well, if there's 0.1% of all the middle and high schools in the world that have 50 student groups, I'd be surprised. One guy in that community 8 years ago took the youth venture idea and said, this is how we turn it around. If we've got a community of change makers, we're a magnet, people aren't fleeing. And he made it happen. So when she at 11 went into Shirley Middle School, she had a problem. And everybody said to her, you got a problem, you solve it, you build a team, look around, that's the way it's done. And she did. Now, what we all have to do is make sure that every middle and high school in the world is in everyone a change maker world, so it is the norm. It's not exceptional to be a change maker, because the world needs everyone to be change makers. And it's cruel, it's awful to allow any person not to have those skills. So there's very direct action here. Everyone here knows a young person. The next time she says something is amiss, puts her book down and quietly say, well, how do you think you could solve that problem? Well, why don't you get your friends together and fix it? Me? Yeah, you can do this. And this is the most important thing you can do. And here's why. And it's okay to drop piano practice. Anyone can do that. And we need to do that for ourselves, for our friends, for our coworkers, and we also have to do it for the organizations we care about. This is a very challenging transition from hierarchy and stovepipes and repetition to an everyone a change maker organization. And just think about this strategic environment. Everyone is bumping everyone else. Everyone is a change maker. They're better and better. Because of SOCAP and the web, the amplitude of bumping is accelerating. That's why the change curve is going up exponentially. It's just a fact. So you need everyone in your organization, whatever it is, to understand the environment they're dealing with, to see the changes, to understand them, to change, to help the people around you change, and to see the opportunities. And then everyone has to come together quickly. Oh, there's a big new value-creating opportunity over here. And we have to create a new team of teams, a different constellation, because it's a new opportunity. And oh, by the way, you don't get to repeat that for 10 or 20 years. So this is a different environment. You have to have everyone a change maker, and that affects every part of your life. And so I just urge you, give yourself permission to recognize this is the strategic change. This is a historic moment. And those who give themselves permission to have the courage to say, yes, this is happening, and this is really good, this is a much better world, that's a great opportunity to serve.
Thank you so much, Bill, and thank you for taking the time with us today. Welcome. Well,
thank you. Great, thanks.
Thank you, Bill.
Great.
All right, everyone. So I have an update for you. Those sessions that it says in your program book are starting at 10:45 are actually starting at 11. We have one more presentation for you, and you don't want to miss it. You may have heard of the National Advisory Board that was convened by the G8 around impact investing that kicked off at SOCAP. The policy recommendations came at SOCAP. And we have Dave Wilkinson from the White House Office of Social Innovation to give us an update on that. He's also just going to speak to what the rest of this term looks like, what's possible after that, and the way that impact investing is influencing the conversation at the highest levels of government. So please welcome Dave Wilkinson.
Thank you so much to be here. And I'm particularly honored to follow Bill Drayton, who is a legend in the field, the original social entrepreneur, and someone who has really paved the way for many of us. What a lot of people don't know about Bill Drayton is that he shares a name with another real, let's say, innovator in another space, the music space. The famous musician Flavor Flav from Public Enemy, also named William Drayton. So I would say Flavor Flav is in great company, and so is the Bill Drayton, who was just on the stage. So I'm really happy to be here with you. I feel like I'm among my people. I spent 10 years in social entrepreneurship and impact investing before I came to the White House. I've been with the White House Office of Social Innovation for about a little over two years. And I'm in a White House right now that's feeling good about things. We have had another great jobs report that just came out last week. More significant than that, that tacked on another month such that we've now had 67 straight consecutive months of job growth. So that's a big deal. In fact, it's a record since we've been keeping track. Unemployment is down to 5.1%. We have created, since 2010, 865,000 manufacturing jobs in the United States. So factories are opening right now at the fastest rate in 20 years. In the last year alone, global investment in the U.S. manufacturing has doubled and is creating great jobs. Inflation is down, gas prices are down, consumer confidence is up. Despite all this economic growth, we are using less energy overall, but much more clean energy. So solar capacity alone has grown 5x in the last 5 years. It's quintupled in 5 years. So we're happy about that, and we're seeing good progress on social indicators as well. Rates of teen pregnancy are down, rates of incarceration are down, rates of veterans' homelessness are down. In fact, we've reduced veterans' homelessness by one-third, a level of reduction that many didn't think possible, and we're not stopping there. We're still making progress on that. Health insurance. You may have noticed that in this administration, we talk about that topic occasionally. And so all that talking and some real hard work and action has paid off. And today, 13 million more Americans have health insurance than when President Obama opened office, came to office. And yeah, it's an accomplishment, not despite some early technical difficulties, which is why I'm going to be using this today. We're going low tech. Here's one of my favorite accomplishments, and then I'll stop burying you in stats, which is that high school graduation rates in the United States are the highest they have ever been. They're the highest on record across all demographics. So that's something people don't know, but we're very proud of and excited about. So we've made a lot of progress during this administration. But the president is also very aware that not everyone has benefited equally from the recent progress. Far too many are still left behind. Far too many are still struggling to get on their feet, still working three jobs to make ends meet, staying up late, wondering how they'll support their family. So here's a stat that's not as comfortable. We know that, due to no fault of their own, 16 million children, 20% of children in the United States, are born into poverty, grow up in poverty. We also know that the circumstances of their birth and their childhood will far too often dictate their opportunities and curb their potential. These children will have worse outcomes across every metric. They will be less prepared for kindergarten. They will endure higher rates of child abuse and neglect. As they grow up, they will have greater likelihood of teen pregnancy. They will be less likely to graduate from high school. They will have higher rates of incarceration. They will have higher rates of unemployment. They will have lower levels of income and lifetime earnings. And they will have higher likelihood of chronic disease. This is a national challenge. We know that the people in this room are working on that. And there's no higher priority for President Obama than addressing these challenges and continuing to make progress. And more than any president before him, President Obama knows that social entrepreneurs, impact investors, social innovators are an essential part of the solution. Yours are sectors that are still young, are still making their way to reaching their full potential, and therefore will be increasingly meaningful in addressing these challenges by creating more stable communities, jobs where we need them most, and creative new solutions that boldly take on challenges that we thought were intractable. So we are bullish on the SOCAP community. The promise and growth and impact that you have shown are among the reasons that the president created the Office of Social Innovation. So what is my office up to? So I'll share just two things. First, our focus on the critical role of impact investing in scaling up the work of high-impact social interventions, the ones that social entrepreneurs are developing, to measurably move the needle on critical challenges. And second, I'll talk about some recent policy victories through the National Advisory Board on Impact Investing, and which has been advancing impact investing and the communities that impact investing supports. So let's start with scaling those high-impact interventions. A big part of our mission in the White House Office of Social Innovation is to create a more outcomes-driven social sector. And so we've been busy helping to create and catalyze a market for social outcomes. And impact investing is playing a big and indispensable role in creating and growing that market. But since I'm with business people, I thought I'd take a moment to share a little of the value proposition of finding the interventions that are working best and achieving the best outcomes, and what that could mean on a national scale. And one could also make implications on an international scale. So there are a number of estimates, and the camera is going to help see this, I'm hoping. There are a number of estimates of total federal, state, local, social spending. One of the more conservative ones is $800 billion a year. That is that we spend $800 billion a year on social service delivery. If you've never seen $800 billion before, that's exactly what it looks like. And of course, we spend that across issue areas: early childhood, K-12 education, child welfare and foster care, community economic development, affordable housing, homelessness, chronic disease management, workforce development, et cetera. And the only reason that we spend resources on these issues and for these people is to get better outcomes for the individuals we're serving. And so we are definitely getting outcomes for the resources that we're spending. But the challenge is we too often don't know what they are. Actually, our first director of the Office of Management and Budget at the White House, Peter Orszag, some of you may have heard of him, says that we have evidence of impact for 1% of total discretionary federal spending. Now, we actually quibble with this number, but the point is well taken, that we don't know enough about the impacts that we're achieving for the dollars that we're spending. So we know some other things. We know that this $800 billion is not meeting current need. I talked about some of the statistics before. We're not meeting current need. We also know that it's unlikely at the federal level, at state and local level, that this number, this combined number, is going to go up significantly anytime soon. It might be hard for some of you to imagine the president and Congress getting together and agreeing to spend substantially more on social services delivery. And that's true in state houses and mayor's offices. So a lot of public policy making and resource spending is dealing with what mathematicians might call a fixed set. And I heard a governor say that a lot of policymaking is robbing Peter to pay Paul. We don't have additional resources to add, so if we want to find money for a new program, we need to find it somewhere else. That is a challenge. And what we're doing when we do that is we're taking resources from one program that we've never studied how well it works, and we're putting them into another program that we will never study how well it works. So that's the bad news. The good news is that we know we have interventions that are working 30 and 50 and 70% better than business as usual. Whether it's high-quality pre-K or nurse home visiting or solutions that are reducing recidivism or reducing the likelihood of childhood abuse and neglect, they are working very well. And so we're working on a program now, Veterans with PTSD, that is connecting them with jobs 270% better than our normal interventions. It's got 22 randomized control trials. So we know certain solutions are working better. What if, and here's the value proposition I was talking about, what if we were down here at this side, and I hope someone can see this on a screen. Oh, we can, that's great. What if we could get, on average, 25% better outcomes, just as a thought experiment, 25% better outcomes for the resources we're spending? Well, that would mean that we would have more buying power. The effective equivalent of 25% of $800 billion. Anybody know what that is? I already wrote it, sorry. $200 billion. So our Congressional Budget Office scored Obamacare, ACA, at $120 billion. We know that $200 billion is like Harry Truman Great Society level investment in social services. And that's what we can achieve by investing in what works. One of our top solutions for this is pay for success. You may have heard of social impact bonds. That is an incredibly important market, enabling government to invest in these solutions that work. I'm not going to go into it because there's going to be a whole session on it, but I want to, for the social investors in the room, I want to convey to you that to date in this market, we're the largest market in the world, over $100 million invested, and that demand for capital is going to grow substantially. To date, supply of capital has been greater than demand. That has real danger of flipping, and as it does, these promising projects are really going to be at risk. We're seeing a lot of potential with high net worth individuals, with CDFIs, with corporate foundations. Google.org just invested in a pay-for-success transaction to reduce chronic homelessness right up the street in Santa Clara County. But we hope that folks will look at this market. In addition, so we're very enthusiastic about that, and it's the centerpiece of the Office of Social Innovation's agenda. I also want to quickly talk about the National Advisory Board for Impact Investing. The members of that in 2013 were announced here at SOCAP. We've got a long history, the White House and SOCAP, with the National Advisory Board. Last year, we announced policy recommendations that were published. And I'm here, there were a lot of skeptics about, well, how useful is it? What's going to happen? We're going to create a task force, nothing happens. Well, I'm here to tell you today that we're making real progress. The Treasury Department just delivered on a major recommendation. And so we are thrilled that the Treasury Department has made it clear that private foundations, which have over $600 billion in assets, can invest their corpus in mission-related investments. This clears a major barrier and provides very significant new access to capital. There are many other policy recommendations of the NAB that are making their way. We have bipartisan support in Congress for the core recommendation on pay for success. And as you know, we're looking at solutions that can unlock $3 trillion in federally regulated pension funds. The Department of Labor is looking at that, and we're hopeful we'll have a good solution. As much as anything, these solutions are about unlocking the capital for the social entrepreneurs in this room, providing the resources to scale the programs and businesses that are going to move the needle. So on behalf of the president, I want to thank you for your time and your dedication and your passion. We have so far to go, and we're so thrilled of your progress. Thank you. Sorry.
y'all can understand why we've run over. There was so much amazing stuff we wanted to tell you, but stay in your seats for just a second. There are three schedule changes that you need to know about. First of all, the monitors at the front of Herbst, which is the building over to your right, where the Impact Hub at SOCAP is located, the monitors there have the schedules, and the changes in the schedule are highlighted. Please check it before you go out. The Davos game is at 2:30 in the Festival Meeting Room 2 behind us. It is in your program book as an hour. It is actually 2 hours long. Also at 2:30, Building Culture to Drive Mission has moved from Building C to Building C, Room C, 2:30. Now, the next session that is starting in here will start in about 3 minutes. Sessions out on the campus are starting at 11:05. Go. If you are staying in here, please move to the front, and we'll start in about 3 minutes.